My name is Sister Kathy Duffy, and as the director of the Institute for Religion and Science at Chestnut Hill College, I would like to welcome you to our Sugarloaf campus and to this evening's lecture. The Institute has as its mission to promote the constructive engagement of religion and spirituality with science and technology, and to encourage dialogue that is interfaith, multidisciplinary, and civil, with an accent on the civil. To this end, so rare in this world, right? To this end, we sponsor lectures, a reading circle, and other events as they come up. Do check our website for resources and for our blog. And if you haven't if you didn't receive an email from us about the events, please be sure to sign up on the sheet in the back, and we'll be sure to let you know about future events. Today we're very fortunate to have as our guest my friend Dr. Michelle Francl. I've known Michelle for 24 years. We just counted it the other day. It's like, oh my goodness, it can't be. Michelle is a woman who is not only a scholar, but a unique and unusually integrated human being, one who brings into balance the many aspects of her life as wife, mother, professor of chemistry, researcher, contemplative, writer, and friend, and a wonderful friend at that. Besides teaching chemistry at all levels, leading a quantum chemistry research team, and developing curricular materials for chemistry classes at Bryn Mawr College, Michelle directs Bryn Mawr's first year seminar program, one that places a heavy emphasis on writing. Her research area is computational chemistry, particularly modeling molecules with unusual structures, such as Möbius strip molecules and reaction transition states. Michelle's group takes an interdisciplinary approach to this problem, mixing computational chemistry with topology and differential geometry. Luckily, she won't be talking about all of those things tonight. Oh, good. Michelle has published her research in scholarly journals such as Journal of Physical Chemistry, Journal of Chemical Education, and International Journal of Quantum Chemistry, and in 2009 was elected a fellow of the American Chemical Society. Michelle is also a writer of some note. Her reflections on the joys and struggles of attempting to live a contemplative life in the midst of the everyday chaos that being a wife, mother, and teacher brings appear regularly in Philadelphia Archdiocese CatholicPhilly.com. And she's also an occasional contributor to Give Us This Day and a regular columnist for the science journal Nature Chemistry. Her essays have appeared in several print collections, including Professing and Parenting and The Open Laboratory, and online at .magus, and This Ignatian Life. Michelle gives the occasional retreat and blogs about prayer, God, and laundry at Quantum Theology. She's very integrated. And I must tell you, she just gave me as a gift, which is delightful, a book in which she has one of the homilies. This is called Sick and Cared for Me. It's homilies and reflections for Cycle B. This is a cheat sheet for priests who are giving their homilies. And Michelle has written one of the homilies in here and also one in the A cycle. So I think we're in for a treat this evening as we walk with Michelle along the subtle edge between science and religion. She knows where she's going since she's been there often. So let's welcome Michelle.
We didn't have to adjust the height on the microphone. which is unusual indeed. So I'm not sure I can live up to that introduction, but I'm going to do my best. I will say about the integration between writing about God, prayer, and laundry, let me recommend to you a wonderful book about Carthusian novices written by a Carthusian novice master. And the beginning of the book is about prayer, and the last chapter is about laundry. I'm not kidding. It's, you know, including stain advice. It's great. So despite having used the word subtle in my title, I want to start off by being absolutely and completely blunt. Credo in unum Deum. I believe in one God. I also accept that the God particle exists, if by that you mean the Higgs boson, along with evolution, quantum mechanics, particle physics, anthropogenic climate change, and the Big Bang theory. The theory, not the television show. I'm a scientist and a practicing Roman Catholic. I'm a contemplative who regularly extricates myself from the interwebs, as my kids tell me I should not call them, and takes up occasional temporary residence in silent monastic enclaves. I'm a quantum mechanic. I've used some of the world's most powerful computers to dig into the interiors of molecules to see what makes them behave and misbehave. And if you're looking at that and you're thinking that that's a rosary, it's not. That's one of my molecules. Although I admit I did choose it because it plays off of that. As Kathy said, I'm a writer, and one who is not ashamed of staring and not ashamed to be attentive to what is there, whether it's the laundry or quantum mechanics. I titled this talk, Working at the Subtle Edge, which is a quote taken from an essay by psychologist and philosopher William James. To do theology, he said, is to work at the subtle edge of things, at the place where words and thoughts expire. James worked at the edge of science and religion, traversing the ground between psychology and mysticism with care and a sharply critical eye. Science, I would like to argue, also walks a subtle edge between what we know and what we can describe. We push language and mathematics in an attempt to express what we understand and don't about the universe. We create new terminology, to say nothing of entirely new fields of mathematics, to describe the natural world, and yet are still left reaching for words that are not there when confronted with particles that can move through solid objects, taking perhaps no time to do so. And at their core, both science and religion are trying to answer the question, why is there something instead of nothing? And it seems like such a, some ways, straightforward question, and I will make no attempt in this talk to answer it. People have tried for thousands of years to answer this question. They will write a book or two books, and I don't think we have time tonight for that. And I have answers, but I won't claim any particular authority about them. So are these two ways of looking at the universe, science and religion, inherently incompatible? Or are they peering over the edge to see the same ridge? What can science and faith tell each other? So Kathy said that she thought I lived an integrated life, and maybe what I want to argue tonight is that we can have an integrated view of science and religion. Edges are often perilous places. Are there risks to working across this edge? So this talk is not meant to convince you that the practice and practitioners of science and religion are never in tension and never have been. This is patently not true. It's not meant to convince you to give over science for religion, or religion for science, for that matter. It is not meant, in fact, to convince you of anything. This talk might be best understood as the field report of a transect, a line set and walked by biologists or geologists, carefully cataloging what they see along the way. Or perhaps you could consider it an account of a particularly challenging and compelling expedition to the edge of the known world. Shackleton's Antarctic journey comes to mind, particularly today. It's cold out there. If we're going to make a transect, it might be useful to have some sense of the ground we're going to tread. And so I'd like to say a little bit about my own personal background and perhaps the broader backdrop. The first point is many scientists simply do not believe in God, however you want to construe it or construct it. So this is data from the Pew Research Center. It's from 2009, but it really, I don't think, has changed much in the last 5 years. So the top is the general public. The bottom is the scientist. Green has some belief in a deity or higher power, and blue does not. And as you can see, the bottom half of the graph, about 48% state unequivocally they don't believe in God, and 7% decline to answer the question. And what I find most interesting is not that more of the general public believe in God than scientists do, but that only 1% of the general public declines to state, but 7% of scientists just refuse to give their opinion one way or the other. And you could attribute many thoughts to that. They don't want to say. They never want to say anything about something they don't have enough data on to say. But we don't know. So scientists may not admit to any more than what they can capture with current theories. And you might be tempted then to dismiss them as having a lack of imagination. Right? We continually are producing new theories in science. Will there be no more theories if you think that science is all that there is? But many contemplative traditions recommend meditation on what is, not what might be, could be, but what is. A contemplation that this particular show me perspective, I think, helps ground. Here's a letter from students in the sixth grade to Albert Einstein in 1936. And they wondered if scientists prayed. And Einstein answers them in a way that would probably put him in the center of the graph and says that scientists believe that every occurrence, including the affairs of human beings, is due to the laws of nature. But goes on to moderate this a bit and say there are things we may not be able to explain, and that, in fact, there is something about the universe that moves many scientists. And it's hard to know what Einstein really believed about this. People have theories. But I'd like to argue, I think, that there is something that moves us. Scientists worry about confounding variables and about having tunnel vision sometimes. And even when it comes to God, we have blind spots. We hope that others might notice them, even if we can't. So I think you need to know a little bit about my perspective so that you know where my blind spots might be. First of all, I'm a theoretical chemist, so I don't do any experiments. People tend to think of when they think I'm a chemist that I mix things in the laboratory. I don't. I use quantum mechanics to understand why molecules misbehave. And Paul Dirac pointed out many years ago that all the necessary equations were known. The only difficulty was they were much too difficult to solve. We now have much more powerful computational techniques as well as computers available that Dirac did not have. And so many of these things are now, if not exactly soluble, nearly enough soluble to tell us something about the natural world. And that's what I do. So I am a way for an atom to know about the world. So Kathy said that I work on molecules that have interesting structures or intriguing structures, and I might say that I work on molecules that misbehave. And so here's an assortment of molecules from problems I've worked on. The one in the middle is a Möbius ring. It's a molecule that has only one side and one edge, and it behaves in ways that really upset the organic chemists. And this is what my research group, I think, has figured out, why they misbehave. So hopefully by the end of the year, my students are excited because they think they're going to get a publication. And I have to say, I'm still excited too. So I teach students, from first year students through graduate students. For almost 30 years, I've prayed the divine office, the Liturgy of the Hours, for almost the last 25 with the local Augustinian community. I live a life that is committed to living out the evangelical counsels, which often get stated as poverty, obedience, and chastity, and sometimes cast that way for monastic vows. For me, these are lived seriously and deliberately, but not as monastic vows. And you might be more comfortable if, and I might be more comfortable if the next piece came up, if I said, in fact, I live a life that is intentionally simple, which attempts to listen deeply and seriously to the world, to my students, and to the natural world, and that tries to live a life of fidelity, to know where I stand and to stand there. So I'd like to start with what are the risks of living at the edge. So I don't see the two mindsets, scientist and contemplative, which is what I'm going to use instead of religious, because I want to focus on that particular perspective of the lived religious experience. So less about being a Roman Catholic and more about thinking about being a contemplative. And there are Christian contemplatives as well as non-Christian contemplatives. So I don't see these two things as being incompatible, and that might be because I'm a quantum mechanic, which requires you to keep multiple realities in mind. Photons behave as discrete particles and as waves. So do electrons and things as large as a helium nuclei. And I realize that I sound strange when I say that a helium nucleus is big, but that's the perspective I come from. God created human beings. Human beings are primates and evolved from older primate species. These are things that I don't see as necessarily being at odds with one another. But I suspect we are most comfortable arguing that scientists can be contemplatives as long as their work as scientists and their work, if we wish to call it that, and I think many of them would, their work as contemplatives are independent of each other. But I would tell you I'm not a mix. I don't believe in some strange mix of quantum mechanics and religion, a quantum theology, despite the fact that's the name of my blog. But I don't compartmentalize the two. I'm not a contemplative part of the time and a scientist another part of the time. I don't leave my faith at the door of the lab, and I don't suspend my critical faculties at the door of the church. And you say, how can you do that? And I point to these wonderful, ambiguous figures. It's the same picture, right? It is the same lines. And depending on how you look at it, you see either the young lady I imagine myself still to be, or the somewhat older woman that I imagine I actually look like to my students these days, with the gray hair. But I would say that depending on how you look at me, you might see the scientist or you might see the contemplative, but it is still the same picture. Yet it's precisely here where I walk on the edge, and perhaps one that's not all that subtle. So I am indeed a mother of one teenager and now one not teenager in college. This is my youngest child jumping off a cliff. I spent 40 minutes talking him into jumping off the cliff. It is a long story, you can ask me later. But the edge that I walk, the cliff that I stand on the edge of, and am not always so quick to jump off in the same way that Chris was not so quick to jump off that ledge, is that I don't necessarily want to tell my colleagues I'm religious. And a conversation about a week ago really points that out. Someone's asking me, I hear you're a writer. And I'm like, yeah. And they're like, what do you write? Do you write science fiction? Do you write romance novels? I'm like, no. And of course, the more I say no, the more they think I must write something that's, you know, really far out. And finally, I sort of admit kind of sheepishly, oh, I write about spirituality, theology, about prayer. And I almost sometimes wish I would say I write about romance novels, because that would feel less awkward. I also don't tend to wave my scientific credentials around at church. And it may seem like humility, but it's not. And it's not necessarily modesty. And it may not even be because of what I think personally about the consonants and tensions between science and faith, but I will admit to more than a nagging worry about what other people think. And what might other people think? So the same kid that's jumping off the cliff comes home one day from school and says to me, one of his friends in class said, people who believe in God are stupid. And I need to tell you that Christopher, at this moment in time, does not believe in God, or at least says he does not believe in God. So I wondered what he had to say to this. And he said, I said, my mother believes in God and she is not stupid. Now, anyone who is raising or has raised a 16-year-old or remembers being 16 might consider this attribution of wisdom to a parent a miracle, and thereby unequivocal proof of the existence of God. We could stop right here, because I'm still not quite sure that I really believe that that happened, but Chris tells me it did. But this is the edge that I fear falling off. If my scientific colleagues discover I believe in God, that I pray, will they lose respect for my work? More precisely, will they worry that I'm unable to be objective, that I will pursue the truth with less vigor, accepting as miracles what is in truth yet to be discovered science? Or will I let my theology drive my science? And while I worry about what my colleagues think, I actually don't fear falling off of the edge into the here is a miracle zone. So this is a pretty famous famous cartoon, and you find it all over the place on the web, but I actually wrote to Sydney Harris and asked permission to use it, and got back a lovely note saying yes, I could. I think he was amused what I was going to use it for. As far as I'm concerned, God is not a God of the gaps, a way for science to wiggle out of a difficulty. There's a wonderful essay by Guy Consolmagno, a Jesuit and an astronomer. He works for the Vatican Observatory, and who was once a professor at Lehigh University in physics. But he has a wonderful essay that addresses this God of the gaps, here lies a miracle, very beautifully, and from his own experience. But the evidence for me as a scientist is overwhelming that the universe operates under a set of rules that, while I believe God can violate, does not choose to do so on any regular basis, Christopher's conversation with his friend notwithstanding. Science deals in the tangible, in the physical. There is a point when any future whys or further whys or whats take you from the physical to the metaphysical, from the realm of physics into philosophy and theology, which is actually exactly how I wandered into it. I kept asking questions in a quantum mechanics class, and the physics professor said to me, you need a philosophy book. And from there, it wasn't too far distant till I was pulling up theology books. The questions that each tackles are somewhat different, though not always. Why is there something instead of nothing? And while the answers that one comes up with are different, I don't think they are actually ever contradictory. Like the humanities and the sciences, there are many ways to measure an elephant and many different ways to construct it. So there is the old tale about the blind men who come in and each of them feels part of the elephant and they come back. It turns out this is a Buddhist parable about what do you see. And the fact that different people will come at a problem and come away with a different perspective. And so it may be that we're all trying to feel up the same elephant, but the sciences and the humanities are coming away from the tail and the trunk. So in this, I want to argue three things. I want to say that I think that scientists and contemplatives share a common methodology. And then I would like to say that there are, argue that there are things that the contemplatives can teach the scientists and that the scientists can teach the contemplatives, so that it could be a two-way street. So I want to suggest, first of all, that scientists and religious, particularly those that we might call contemplatives and mystics, share common ground, that they have common methodologies. And this is a fascinating paper, because not only is it a observational report of what scientists saw in people's brains, but the people whose brains they were looking at gave them information about what it means to be a contemplative and a mystic in order to set up the experiment. So it's a rather, it's only three pages long, and if anyone wants it, send me an email and I can send you the PDF. So the first thing I want to start with, though, is a test. No grades for this one. The prompt is, and you know, do it in your head. You don't have to have a piece of paper. Draw a scientist. What does a scientist look like? And this is actually an honest to heaven social science experiment. So what do you see when you see a scientist? What do people see?
White lab coat.
White lab coat. What else?
Einstein's hair.
Male or female? Male. Yeah, I see a male too, and I teach at a women's college. What else do you see?
Beard.
A beard? Maybe glasses? Right. So here are two results from the Draw a Scientist test. And often what you see is glasses, lab coat, wild hair, right? Some hair is more wild than others. Lab bench and things bubbling away. If you code these drawings, this is what you see. Almost uniformly, everyone draws a man with crazy hair, glasses, working in a chemistry lab. We suppose that scientists are concerned with the real, the tangible, using methods that are objective and don't admit of the personal. The personal, in fact, matters so little, they pay no attention to their appearance. So we get bad hair and uniforms of rumpled white lab coats. The hard-edged and the tangible, we see the lab bench and the beakers. Though immersed in the study of nature, we don't actually show them working in the field, but isolated, sealed away from nature and perhaps from beauty. Okay, part two of the test. Draw someone meditating or imagine someone meditating. What do you see? Buddha, what else?
Someone kneeling.
Head bowed. Eyes closed. Hair? Bald, right? Bald hair. So there isn't a contemplative test, but you can put contemplative into Google and ask what you see. And these are images that come up. And including the cup sitting on the, you see a lot of lakes. That's the other thing that you see. Heads bowed, kneeling, sitting. And maybe this might be the iconic image. This is Thomas Merton, drawn by Thomas Merton. So we see them immersed in nature and in color. We see mystery and smell incense. They're uniforms are graceful robes, right? No one is dressed in rumpled things with messy hair in any of those pictures. And in fact, many of them have no hair to be mussed at all. So I suspect we put contemplatives at the opposite pole of scientists. One side considers the transcendent and the mystical, God, taking approaches that are intensely personal. The others study the hard, tangible nature that is right in front of them, using techniques that are absolutely objective. But contemplative scientist is not as much an oxymoron as you might think. Ask Gregor Mendel, father of modern genetics, and do you know what his day job was? He was an Augustinian monk. Jesuit Walter Burkhardt once defined contemplation as a long, loving look at the real, which is not a bad description of science either. Scientists spend a long time. If you saw the drop experiment where someone was waiting for that drop of tar to fall for, I think, 25 years, that's a long, it's got to be loving, look at the real. And in fact, I did an interview for a book review I wrote, and I quoted that, and that's what they used as the title. So now if you Google up long loving look at the real, instead of getting the articulate Walter Burkhardt, you get me, for which I feel bad. So here are a bunch of people that you might think of in various ways, and maybe I'll just put them all up here and say who they are. Some of them you might recognize. So Kathy Duffy, a sister of St. Joseph and a physicist. This is Elizabeth Lundgren. She is or was a Buddhist nun until she put down her robes and returned to the chemistry lab. She is a synthetic organic chemist. Gregor Mendel, Augustinian monk, and his notebook. This is John Klassen. He's the abbot of St. John's Monastery, Benedictine Monastery in Minnesota. He's also a physical chemist. That's him in his lab. This is Brother Guy Consolmagno, and this is Brother Guy with his meteor collection. This is Brother Guy with another chemist, a fellow chemist, who's looking at one of the samples through the microscope. And it's hard to see in this picture, but you can tell that this guy in the white robes is really a chemist, because when he gets up close to the lab bench, he knows better than to actually touch it with his clothes. He stands back and bends over in a very characteristic pose of a scientist looking through a microscope. So 5 years ago, on a sabbatical leave, I spent 30 days in wintry silence. There were two blizzards over the 30 days, making St. Ignatius of Loyola's spiritual exercises. When Pope Francis was elected, I had a whole flurry of emails from the young Jesuits who had been on this experience with me, and they were really excited because two of us were chemists. I was and one of the young Jesuits, and they're like, we have a chemist for Pope. Not that we have a Jesuit for Pope, but not that we have someone from South America as the Pope. No, we have a chemist as the Pope. So it was an interesting experience. But when I came back, someone asked me, why would I do such a thing? Why would a middle-aged mother of teenagers and a scientist find something so compelling about a spirituality birthed in 16th century Europe, awash in mystics, pilgrims, and explorers? And maybe it's all that. It's mystical, it's being on pilgrimage, it's a way of seeing how God permeates the ordinary, and it's integrative, not divisive. And for me, maybe that was the ultimate reason to go. I'm challenged by an approach to life that's all in, that's willing to take the mystic's leap into the unknown, whether that's an unknown piece about a molecule that's misbehaving, or the unknown leap into the contemplative space. How and why was this all made? St. Ignatius' spirituality pushes me to recognize that I'm a pilgrim clutching at a rough map, but not always as sensible as conditions, to borrow a phrase from Annie Dillard's amazing essay called An Expedition to the Poles, which weaves together liturgy, speaking of like liturgy, prayer, and laundry, liturgy and Shackleton's expedition to the Antarctic. And this is the quote that's taken from. It's madness to wear ladies' straw hats and velvet hats to church. We should all be wearing crash helmets. She thinks that we're not very sensible of conditions. But some of the habits that come from making the exercises of looking over the day as data and recording notes reminds me that what I do as a scientist can also be pulled into the metaphysical realm. There is something that scientists have to say to metaphysicians. It helps us learn to be sensible of conditions. Perhaps because of my scientific bent, I appreciate Ignatian spirituality's attention to the details, not just in prayer, but in all of life, including my laboratory. In his 1952 Nobel Prize address, physicist Edward Purcell, he's the one who discovered the physics underlying NMR and then eventually MRI, and this is a figure taken from one of his papers. This is what he observed. "I've not yet lost a feeling of wonder and of delight that this delicate motion should reside in all the ordinary things around us, revealing itself only to him who looks for it. I remember in the winter of our first experiments, just 7 years ago, looking on snow with new eyes. There the snow lay around my doorstep, great heaps of protons quietly processing in the Earth's magnetic field." If Purcell doesn't sound like a mystic to you, he certainly does to me. And like Purcell, I delight in eyes to see what resides in the ordinary things, the wonders that lie just beneath their surface. And yeah, every time I look at the piles of snow before I have to sweep them off the car or shovel them up, I do think about Purcell and all those protons quietly processing in the Earth's magnetic field. Faith cannot overrule science. And the popular view of Galileo's difficulties notwithstanding, in fact, the Roman Catholic Church has not taught otherwise. Saint Augustine came down very heavily on people who thought they knew something about theology but didn't know anything about the natural world. And Saint Thomas Aquinas said, "The truth of our faith becomes a matter of ridicule among the infidels if any Catholic, not gifted with the necessary scientific learning, presents as dogma what scientific scrutiny shows to be false." Simply because the book of Genesis said that God told Noah to bring pairs of each animal, male and female, does not mean that each species necessarily has two sexes, male and female. This can make for an uncomfortable tension at times with others of faith not gifted with the necessary scientific learning. I'll pick on Catholics because I am one. Catholic pundits regularly ridicule anyone who supports anthropogenic climate change, global warming. It's earth worship. My stance on climate change has nothing to do with paganism and earth worship, and everything to do with an understanding of the intimate molecular workings of carbon dioxide and the interplay between historical data and large-scale modeling of the atmosphere. So I'll ask us to take a contemplative stance at this. Is that graph going up or down? Up. If it's a stock, would you buy it? Most people answer yes. This actually has been used in a survey by Pew. People will tell you that graph is going up, and if it's a stock, they will buy it. It's global temperatures for the last 150 years. We have something to learn by looking at things as they are. What is? So what can scientists teach contemplatives? What can science say to religion? We can say something about not letting myth drive answers and an openness to upending constructs when what sits in front of us says that we must. So this is an example taken from quantum mechanics. You have a wave, it hits a barrier, and if I throw a ball at the wall, what happens? It bounces back, right? Quantum mechanically, at that level, you can throw a ball at a wall and it will go through and come out the other side. And in fact, in this room, there are a lot of nitrogen molecules, and these nitrogen molecules are all gently vibrating. And about 20% of them are vibrating in such a way that they are violating classical mechanics. So take a deep breath and know that with every breath you take, quantum mechanics is happening right here in this room. Okay? So when confronted with this reality, we need to upend our theories and say, what can we now say given what we see? What is here before us? Even a non-Christian knows something about the earth, the heavens, and the other elements of this world. It's disgraceful and dangerous to hear a Christian, presumably given the meaning of Holy Scripture, talking nonsense about these things. That's St. Augustine. So the church for a long time has been advocating, see what is there, and theology must follow. And I'm missing, I know what slide is missing. All right, we're going to look at the little thing down in the corner. There's a pretty famous example about scientists sometimes cannot see what they want, what they're looking for, because of their own preconceived notions about letting myth drive the answers. So there were a set of biochemists looking for the protein that allowed, and this comes from a book about science and God, that batters at the walls of the egg, strips away the egg's coating, and allows the sperm to force its way in. They were unable to locate such a protein because there is no such protein. Their biblical idea of what was happening did not actually match the biochemistry. In fact, the egg is the one that drags the sperm in. You can go from there. But scientists learn not to fear doubt. And theologian Paul Tillich says, doubt is not the opposite of faith. It's one element of faith. And I think this is one thing, in addition to the ability to see what is in front of you and use that to reevaluate, that religion could learn from science. And they could also learn not to fear doubt, because I think scientists enjoy doubt rather than fear it. So what can contemplatives teach scientists about working at the subtle edge where words and thoughts expire? So I think there are four things. Scientists and mystics both approach the universe from a contemplative perspective, as a mysterious and wonderful place, and both with an interest in using well and wisely what they find out. So what can they teach? I think there are four things. An awareness of the multiple dimensions with which we engage the physical world, verbal, audible, visual. Doing science in a slow and deliberate way, slow food, slow science. It's an antidote to the mechanical, and there should be a sense of joy in it. I love this painting of Magritte. There are multiple ways to see reality, and certainly quantum mechanics believes in this, that you can see a photon as a wave, you can see a photon as a particle, and sometimes it's helpful to try to hold both in your mind at once. The ability to look and see, particularly the ability to take detailed field notes without trying to judge what's happening. Robert Boyle, a chemist, was a really vocal champion of doing research, as he said, in the presence of an illustrious assembly. And he actually thought the standard procedure for publishing should not be to write a paper, but in fact to do the science publicly and have everyone kind of wander around and poke at it. And that's what would count as official publication of your results, not anything that you wrote up. He eventually bent and realized that this was not practical, but he long favored incredibly detailed drawings of what was going on in the experiments, not just of the apparatus, but of what was happening. And if you look really closely in the back thing, you see something rising up out of the back. That's a snake. And he's trying to show you one of the experiments he did that eventually led people to understand what happened with the bends. It took people a long time to figure out that nitrogen under pressure was dangerous. And this set of experiments that Boyle did with the snake, while pretty ghastly by modern standards, were detailed enough to help people unravel it without unraveling any more snakes. Contemplative practice is a practice that trains us to appreciate a richness of description and of particulars, what St. Ignatius would have called the composition of place, and that I might argue means that scientists need to have more than a bit of the poet about them, too. Jane Hirschfield, who's a Buddhist poet, has a beautiful poem called Optimism. In the very end of it, she says, "But out of such persistence arose turtles, rivers, mitochondria, figs, all this resinous, unretractable earth." It's about the particular, and the particular in a very detailed way. I almost took a picture of the students in the back when I came in. There was a whole row of you, and you were sitting there holding your phones. So when you see this picture here, what do you think about? Yes, I think about people texting. I took this picture at the Met, and I really seriously almost took a picture of you all lined up, partly because the color scheme of the chairs matched as you're all texting. It's a fast world, right? We say we live in an information overload. Our practices as scientists often favor the fast and the frantic over the attentive and the reflective. These days, journals will advertise, fast track to publication. As soon as you click go on the proofs, they show up on the web. How fast, how much can we communicate? But historian of science Gerald Halton notes that the developments in science that have been most critical have depended on an unforced pace of work. These are skills that contemplatives have in full measure. And here's an example, and it's a particularly good Philly example. So maybe I should show this in an opposite order. Do you know what this picture is? It's an X-ray, right? And it's a pretty famous X-ray. It's one of the very first X-rays taken, except it's not. And you think that this X-ray was taken in Europe? Because Röntgen is the name that you associate with that, right? The first X-ray was taken in Philadelphia and is this. So it was taken by two men, Godspeed and Jennings, and they were demonstrating physics apparatus in Philadelphia, and their apparatus generated X-rays, which they didn't quite know. But they did know that they generated energy, and they had photographic plates, and they were experimenting with them. And at the end, somebody put his trolley fare down on top of the plates, and they were exposed. And they were in such a rush to gather things up that they weren't too sure what happened. Had this plate been deliberately exposed or not? And when they developed it, they couldn't figure it out. And they sent telegrams back and forth to each other across Philadelphia. Some days before telephones and emails, now you know what scientists did. They sent telegrams to each other. And they didn't really figure out what was going on. And part of it is because they were in a real rush. And in the end, they filed it away as a mystery. And they didn't try to repeat the experiments. And when this picture appeared in the newspaper, they actually both immediately knew what they had. And they pulled it back out of the files, and they wrote a nice note to Röntgen and said, "Congratulations on recognizing what it was we had already seen." And the interesting thing is that we have the prints, but the original X-ray has been lost. It's somewhere in the archives at the American Philosophical Society, perhaps. No one's totally sure. But at heart, science is a contemplative enterprise. Even if the media would have us think otherwise, fast, latest, new, scientists discover, scientists need to think about what they have sometimes for a long time before they know what they see. And do I have? Maybe not. If I have a little time at the end, I'll tell you a story from my own research about contemplating something for 2 years. science moves fast, but we might listen to Annie Dillard in The Writing Life and her advice to friends discouraged by their writing pace. Out of a human population on Earth of 4.5 billion, perhaps 20 people can write a serious book in a year. Some people lift cars, some people enter week-long dog sled races, go over Niagara Falls in barrels, fly planes through the Arc de Triomphe. I didn't know that it actually happened, but it did. There is no call to take human extremes as norms. Contemplative practice encourages a deliberate, even slow pace, a spaciousness that internally and externally should be valued. Third, it's an antidote to utilitarianism and reductionism. The position that the realm of science is entirely encompassed by the scientific method. And this is a piece from the Dead Sea Scrolls. To this one might say, to whom can you liken God? Who has measured the waters in the hollow of his hand or with the breadth of his hand marked off the heavens? Not everything about even the physical universe is knowable or at least quantifiable. The Heisenberg uncertainty principle says that knowing the exact position and exact velocity of an electron is not possible. Building a better measuring device will not help. It is simply not knowable. Psychologist William James takes a similar tack in the realm of the metaphysical. He says that one marker of a mystical experience, which perhaps we might say is an experience of God, is that they are ineffable, indescribable. So is an electron a mystical experience? To be a scientist who has eyes of faith is to recognize there is always more to know, and that what we can see and touch is a portal into things we cannot see or touch, and which we often fail of the words to describe. So the last thing I would say is that contemplatives cultivate a sense of wonder, sense of joy. And if you talk to a scientist and ask them why do they do science, they may tell you that, you know, it will save the world, it will cure cancer, it will tell us something about what will happen. But if you push them, they will tell you they do it for the joy of it, for the delight of the discovery, for the pleasure in figuring out the puzzle. Maria Gerbert Meyer, who won the Nobel Prize, said the prize was a wonderful thing, but the greatest joy was the work itself. And I think that sums it up well. That's one of my students, and we were doing something in the lab which required cooling with carbon dioxide, solid carbon dioxide, dry ice. And when they put it in the sinks and put hot water on it, they got these sinks full of clouds. And, you know, they're sophisticated students, they're seniors and juniors, and watching them cup their hands and hold this and play with it, the sense of wonder that I was so glad they had not lost in all of the exams and tests and papers we had set them. And I will just say, I wrote an essay about beautiful molecules and my favorite molecules. And when they published it in Nature Chem, I loved that the caption was, Michelle's top 10 beautiful molecules, you know? It's a very personal set of choices, and you might argue about them. People did. From my perspective, religion is not a big book of rules, nor is science a big book of facts. Neither of them are reducible to just the sum of a series of mechanical actions. We are not the Stepford Wives, whether we are monks or scientists. Making the sign of the cross or being able to recite the Ten Commandments does not make me religious. Memorizing the periodic table does not make me more or less of a chemist. I don't love my children or my spouse because they clean up or don't clean up the kitchen after dinner. It's how we wield the facts. Let the rules frame our practices that make me a person of faith, that make me a scientist. I love my husband and my children, my science and my God, in ways I could never possibly say. Ah, that's the slide that should have gone with that. Oh well. I'll go back to that one. Religion should not fear science. Okay. I have one son who's a science major and the other one's a humanities major, so this might actually be our family motto. And no, please do not clone the Tyrannosaurus Rex in the basement. The universe is sometimes called God's other book of revelation. St. Anthony the Great, who was a 4th century monk who lived isolated in the desert, when someone said, oh, you don't have any books, he said, my book is the nature of created things. And as often as I have mine to read the words of God, they are at my hand. 16 centuries later, the universe is still God's other book there for us to read. It's just that nowadays it can be helpful to know some calculus if you want to get all the details of the plot straight. Science should not fear religion. Both scientists and mystics approach the universe from a contemplative perspective, as a mysterious and wonderful place, and with an interest in using wisely and well what has been revealed. Neither should fear doubt. I can't prove the existence of God in the same way I can prove the existence of these notes. But like much of science, direct observation is neither always possible nor necessary. I have never seen an electron, and I cannot prove its existence in the same way I can prove the existence of these notes. But I am convinced of their existence because I can see their traces. No one has held a Higgs boson in their hand. Well, I guess, is that necessarily true? I don't know. But its tracks convince us that it might indeed exist. I believe in God. I have seen God's tracks in science and outside of it. Barbara McClintock, who won the Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine in 1983, said, things are more marvelous than the scientific method would allow us to perceive. And I would say to that, indeed. So now I want to say thank you, because gratitude is a contemplative practice. So first of all, thank you all for your attention and coming out on a cold night to listen. And thank you to Kathy for the invitation to give this talk and to think about this. But I should also say thank you to the students who have done some of the work on the molecules that I showed. The top one is also my child, but who has done research with me. And Shirai, Camilla, and Deepa all worked on the merbiocene molecule. And Matt Wampole worked on some of the molecules which have a flat plate and weird rotations and do some incredibly cool quantum mechanical things, which I won't talk about at all. I have to thank Bishop Daniel Thomas, who's now the Bishop of Toledo. He was in the Archdiocese of Philadelphia. He taught me systematic theology, so if I'm ever heretical, it's his fault. And he's also the person who invited me to start writing for the Catholic Philadelphia paper, which I did for many years. I gave a version of this talk for the Franklin Institute, and there was a wonderful give and take answer session, which really helped me refine my thinking about it, and so I should thank them. Matt Gambino is the editor of Catholic Philly. James Carr is the person who directed those exercises on that wintry time up in Massachusetts. And the Center for the Contemplative Mind and Society has supported some of the work that I've done writing about this. And the NSF occasionally gives me money to do science, and the Klaus Fund pays part of my salary. And these are all the people in my life, maybe some of them, who've made a difference. So thank you. And then you can figure out what that is.
Right, let's see if we can have even more exciting questions than they had at the Franklin, or the, was the Franklin Institute? Yeah, the Franklin Institute. Thank you, Michelle, for a marvelous talk. So who wants to go first?
I'm not a global warming denier, but I do have a question. You did put the chart up there about increasing temperatures. What persuades you that that is caused by human activity?
Yes, I can use the microphone. I'm not going to go through all of it, but there you can show that the observed temperature increase matches the models, which show that CO2 is driving it. And the models are good enough for me to say that that might be true. You can also see the increase of carbon dioxide in, so why you might worry about it. Henry's law says as you increase the amount of carbon dioxide in the air, the amount dissolved in water, oceans or otherwise, will increase. And we're reaching the point where we'll have enough dissolved in the oceans that it will simply dissolve the coral reefs. It won't just kill them, they will just vanish. That's fairly significant. But the models to me are very, very convincing. And there's, what do I want to say? There's a wonderful site which is done by a number of climate scientists, and it tries to look at the various claims that are made and help walk you through them in language that's accessible to somebody who's not a climate scientist. So that's where I would go for more detail.
Thank you.
I wonder if you could tell us your two-year science project, the one you thought about for 2 years?
Oh, the one I thought about for 2 years. Thank you for asking that. Now I can tell it. So, I should have brought a picture, but I didn't. All right. So, there are a whole set of molecules called catalysts, which act, and you add a small amount to something, and it can make the reaction happen over and over again. So you can make things like polymers, or in this case, what you can do is link two molecules together, two smaller molecules together. And there was a whole set that linked backwards. So you use this aluminum reagent, and you put it in there, and the metal bonded to it, and every prediction said the metal should bond in this way, and then the two should come together, let's say, face to face. But they didn't. They came together face to tail. And people wondered about this, and I modeled the transition state for it. I used, I cannot tell you how many hours of supercomputer time trying to unravel all of this. And finally, I made a picture, and I stuck it up on the wall in front of my desk. And there it sat for 2 years, and periodically, I would just sit and look at this picture. And it's got this, you have to imagine, it's got this big, giant aluminum atom here, which was displayed in the picture my students had made in bright violet, okay, vivid violet. And carbon is typically shown in as chemists as black, and hydrogen is white. So it's got these black things and this big purple thing, and it's a metal. And we know metals are really, like, reactive. And everyone's looking at the metal. And one day I stopped looking at the metal, and I realized that what was happening was a very straightforward organic reaction, and the only thing the metal was doing was holding things together in the right position. And everything worked exactly as it should go. This organic reaction ought to go face to tail, and it did. And once I could see that, it was like the old lady and the young lady. You just shifted your perspective from looking at that metal, all that metal right there, that bright violet thing, to the outside, to realize I could see it as something else. And I don't think that if I hadn't left it plucked up in my office in front of my face and looked at it, every time I was on hold on the telephone, actually, I would sit there and look at it and think, why does this work the way it works? 250 hours of supercomputer time, and I don't know why it works the way it works. But now I do. So that's the story. That's slow science.
Yes, well, my concern is the regular use, the common use of the word why, for the simple reason that why, while science answers the local why, it never answers the longitudinal why.
Yes.
We just become satisfied. Really, we can invent situations, hypothetical fields, and somebody says, well, you can ignore the field. Now all we have to do is forget about the fields, just twist space. It has the same effect. And we get away with it that way. But the ultimate why is not in the realm of science, surely.
No, it is not. Why I say they're not contradictory. Guy Consolmagno's essay brings out that point really rather beautifully. I mean, he talks about Stephen Hawking's argument that it was a random quantum fluctuation that set the universe into motion. But he says that's not nothing, right? That's still not something out of nothing. And the point is that, you know, that something out of nothing has to be outside of our realm. And so he says it argues for a much larger view of what God is, that he doesn't believe in Hawking's God either, or the God that Hawking is refuting, I would say in that.
Thank you.
That's a nice segue to my question. You've thought long and hard about science and faith and live very comfortably in both. Why, and as indeed scientists have for since science came to be during the Renaissance, let us say, although the roots of science go farther back than
that,
of course.
We'll put it there.
Persons of science were always persons of faith until, let's say, Darwin came along or something like that. But even post-Darwin, many scientists have been and continue to be people of faith. Where do you suppose the hostility of a Richard Dawkins comes from? Why can't he accept that some people see no contradiction? Why does he insist on imposing his view?
That's a good question. And I guess I have a hard time understanding a view of something that holds so tightly to a single reading. And I think that someone like Stephen Hawking has a very single reading of what counts as data. And so he might disregard the lived experience of people as data. And I would argue that you can count people's lived experience. So what do you say about someone who's had a mystical experience? And, you know, what do you say about the, you know, I'm going to say that the fMRI data doesn't say anything really about mystical experiences. But I would think that part of the hostility comes from the fact that people are not as reproducible as protons. And so you can do the same experiment with people five times and people are not generally as cooperative as the protons in doing the same thing over and over again. So maybe it's that, but I guess I'm not so quick to throw away human experience in all of this. And I read Purcell and I think that man was a physicist, but you know, his look at the snow and the protons is, if he'd had that pre-Renaissance and went to tell somebody at the local church, they would have called that a mystical experience. You know, your ability to see inside the snow, so.
Kathy introduced you as a very integrated woman, very contemplative and scientific, contemplative/scientific. So was there a time in your life that there was more of a split within you, that you didn't know the marriage of contemplation and science as deeply as you know now?
Probably not. Mm. So, and part of this has to maybe do in the spot that I grew up in. Uh-huh. So I grew up living behind the convent and with two parents who were scientists.
Wow.
And so everything was on the table all the time. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. And neither side was dissing each other.
Yeah.
And so I think that gave me the idea growing up that you could be both. Wow. And so it wasn't. So, the sisters that lived behind me, one of them had studied math in college, so it didn't occur to me that is somehow incompatible with being, you know, are religious. So I think those examples probably set in motion something, which may then say it's not reproducible. I don't know.
So location is the
location
mother of all, is everything, right?
Yeah, location,
right.
location.
Yeah, that's fascinating. And Marie Montessori herself, in studying young children and observing young children, of course, she was a medical doctor. She herself said that young children are the most metaphysical of all creatures, and so prone to wonder that that's something from which we can continue to learn.
Right.
And I give credit to young children for my
right. There is nothing like watching, if you're a scientist, there's nothing like watching young kids figure something out or not figure something out. I can still watch my oldest holding on to this helium balloon. You know, he's at the age where they drop everything and hope that you'll pick it up. They're trying to see if gravity always works. And he let go of the helium balloon, and he looked down, and of course the balloon went up, and the look of shock on his face, I can still see, because, you know, he had his idea about how the universe worked, and the universe just violated it, and he's trying to figure it out.
That's a great story. Thank you.
Religious people are often accused of being too dogmatic or too rigid and so forth, but a lot of scientists are too. And I think there's a need for more modesty among scientists. I think chemists are actually a little more modest because we actually run reactions, and you can model things all you want. And I spent a lot of my time, you know, figuring out what was going to happen, and it didn't. I mean, we were never as smart as we thought we were.
Yeah, no, the atoms always have it.
And so when you want to talk about, you know, people like Dawkins and so forth are so sure of things, but I think they all need to be a little more modest about what they do, much as religious people ought to be a little more modest, because you really don't know. I mean, there's so much you don't know, and even after we've done a lot of these things, we've accomplished something, but we never knew exactly what was going on exactly. You know, you always had this idea, dream that you could be this little person who could go into the chemicals and see what was actually going on, because we didn't know. So I think people who actually run experiments, who actually do things new, are a lot more modest about things than people who just do theory.
I'm going to be careful. There are too many physicists in the audience. But I would say that to me is part of that contemplative stance about what is as opposed to what you might wish it to be, and the ability to look and then still question, why did that happen? And to me, maybe this is my Ignatian bent, this idea that you might look at the data, change things and see what happens and change it up again. And that's certainly a chemist's way of approaching things, and maybe a very experimental way of approaching things. So that may be a piece of it. But I think, too, you know, we like to think we know what's going to happen. I like control as much as anybody.
I was just going to say, you know, in reference to Peter's question, what I find when I listen to some of the new atheists, you know, who seem to, you know, consider only science the only way to truth, is that they have a very limited understanding of religion. They're looking at a single strand that's very simplistic itself, you know, and so they might be right to batter that science, that religion, but you know, those who are really looking at religion more deeply, I think, is beyond their ken.
Right, the difference between religion as a big book of rules as opposed to something that is more integrated.
Thank you for a very inspiring and thought-provoking lecture. I really enjoyed it.
Well, thank you.
And as someone who's maybe equally at home with the writings of the anonymous author of The Cloud of Unknowing, and also talk about dark energy or black holes, and seems also to understand something of other faiths like Buddhism, I'm just struck by the idea What does your experience teach you, if anything, about the question, could a nothing be as profound as a something? I'm just very curious about that. I would be grateful for any light on that topic. Thank you.
I don't know that I can provide light on the darkness. I would say that my own experience suggests that there's a lot of imagery that goes around emptying and emptiness in contemplation. So the kenotic, to use the Christian term for it, and which seems to suggest that there is an experience of this nothing, right? That we say something came from. That's probably not really helpful. I had a long conversation with a Buddhist monk about this, about what does it mean to contemplate nothing. And there are some set Buddhist contemplations of things like nothing. So I think I would say that it shows up in enough different threads that to me it feels like a common experience of the universe. How's that? And I think that the people who are willing to write about their experiences of it are very brave. I don't know that I'm willing to talk about my experiences of it, but I think are very brave. There is a beautiful book by Barbara Brown Taylor that just came out in the last year called Walking in Darkness, that explores some of the contemplative approaches to darkness. And there's a little bit of science in there, but not a lot. But she covers a lot of ground, not deeply, because that's not what she's trying to do. I think she's trying to more or less sort of sketch out a map of dark matter and spirituality. So that might be a place to
thank you
to
very
look.
Much for the book reference. My students have been reading Gay Watson's A Philosophy of Emptiness lately. And
Yeah. This will not be as heady as that.
Thoroughly enjoyed your talk.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. This might be, it's in one sense a very practical question and also somewhat personal. Have you developed a conceptualization of the survival of human consciousness beyond bodily death? And I'm not necessarily thinking of consciousness as a projection of our experience here on Earth, but have you thought about that much? Well, I'm sure from a personal point of view, you know, don't we all? But could you speak to that?
Yeah, this is when I'm glad I had the conversation at the Franklin Institute, because someone asked about things like that. I mean, I could fall back on the creed that I started this talk with, which ends with, I believe in the communion of saints. I believe in the resurrection of the body. I can say those words, but what does that mean? So when I say I believe in the communion of saints, I think what I mean by that is that there is a persistence of ourselves beyond this life. And that persistence is somehow connected to our connectedness to each other across time and across space. I don't pretend to have any idea how that works. I would say I have personal experiences that suggest to me that there is a reality there that I can't necessarily express, and certainly enough other people have them as well. So I think that would be my answer. And it was someone asked me that at the Franklin Institute, you know, what do I believe? And it was a young man. He stood up and he was maybe 16, and he said, you know, don't you believe that your body, you know, completely disintegrates and goes back to carbon dioxide and water? And I said, I do. And he says, well, how do you believe in the resurrection of the body? And I said, you know, I'm really curious. And that, you know, as a scientist, I'm really curious. And the poor person moderating it said, not curious enough to, you know, do anything, are you? I'm like, no. But you know, I don't know that I have a way to talk about that, because, of course, there is the resurrection of the body. It's a standard chemistry problem that you can work. How many molecules in the deep breath that you took were once breathed by pick, some historical figure, Julius Caesar, Jesus Christ. In some ways, we're all each other's resurrected bodies, right? In a very factual and scientific way, if you could tag this particular carbon atom and follow it through, or that particular oxygen atom, you know, it's all, we are all indeed sharing a single body. I don't know if that answers anything. I still don't know what's going to happen when I die.
Well, it's very evocative and helpful for me, because I don't think that necessarily the afterlife is necessarily a projection of what we experience here on Earth, because we're so limited vis-a-vis what we experience here on Earth.
But I'm.
It's got to be bigger than that.
I rather hope that we're not all sitting together in a room watching me lecture at the other end. And so, you know, so I don't know, I guess, is what it is. But at least from the scientific view, it gives me a hook to imagine something bigger. Maybe that's the piece.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Is there something?
I enjoyed your lecture very much tonight, and
thank you.
Slides were great. I love your slides.
Oh, good, I pass.
I have a different kind of question. It's more of a science question. A lot of sciences invokes determinism, cause and effect determinism, mm-hmm. and you're a specialist in quantum mechanics.
Right.
Which in many circles suggests indeterminacy.
Now,
I'm
right.
not a scientist, but a lot of philosophers and theologians and some scientists have speculated that quantum indeterminacy can somehow be the basis for free will, which has a lot of support in Christian theology.
Right.
What are your thoughts or comments on that? Thanks.
All right. I definitely, as a quantum mechanic, am of the probabilistic sort. Even though I don't necessarily believe that God throws dice for everything, I think for some things maybe God does throw dice. So I'm always reluctant to push the science too far into the philosophy or the theology, because sometimes I wonder if, from my perspective as a quantum mechanic, I worry that there's something I'm missing about the philosophy. And with the philosophers, I'm always wondering if they're missing a little bit about the quantum mechanics when we have a conversation. So I'm going to hedge my bets, as most good scientists will, and say that I'm unwilling to say that quantum indeterminacy is necessarily the root of human free will. But I will say that I'm not so deterministic as a scientist, that I believe things have fuzzy edges. So it's that I showed that tunneling picture. So it might not it doesn't bother people so much to think about the particle tunneling through a wall and coming out the other side, right? So if I throw a ball at the wall and it goes through and pops out the other side, you might say, wow, you might say miracle, but you're not really, I think, shaken to your core. But try this. This falls out of the same mathematics. If you shoot a ball over the top of the wall, some percentage of the time when it gets to the point of the wall, it bounces back off of nothing. And I frankly find that much more disturbing. I mean, it's like thinking about a, you know, airplane flying over a mountain, and even if it's across the mountain, above the altitude of the mountain, sometimes it will hit the mountain. Edges are fuzzy. And I think that when I talk about working at the subtle edge, I think it's an awareness that there are edges that we cannot necessarily sharply divide. And that might be one of them. I don't know if that helped.
Shall we make this the last question then?
I think the problem could be avoided if instead of it's no longer a particle, it's no longer a wave, just call it a wavicle.
Yes, people have, okay. And people indeed have called it a wavicle, but I think that we always are trying to attach the properties to something that we know. Yes. We're always scaffolding. And so, you know, we want to scaffold this piece on a particle, this part on a wave. I just finished an essay about benzene, which is a very famous molecule, right, where the bonds, it's got, well, okay, I disappeared. The little hexagons that were up there, I think they're going to come back. The hexagons that come up there, you know, are there bonds two alternating between each other, or is it all a single piece? And how do you hold that in your mind? How do you show that? And the essay is illustrated with 15 different ways to show that, that all have been used in the published literature. So none of which is perfect. And they're all trying to get at the same reality, which is the molecule that Kathleen Lonsdale saw all the bonds to be the same length on.
Thank you.
Thank you, Michelle, and thank you for all of you who have asked such good questions and been such a good audience. I just want to be sure that you know what's coming up, because this free will problem will be settled in February. Dr. Tamara will be talking about the free will problem, insights from physics. Now, the physicists know. And so that's February 2nd, same time, same place. And then in March 16th, we'll have Ron Cole Turner talking about transhumanist dreams and Christian hopes. So that should be very interesting and, you know, a little bit closer to your questions too, I think, Frank. And then finally in April 16th, we'll have Phil Clayton coming in from California talking about the emergent mind, what brains and cognition tell us about faith. So be sure to come back. Okay, thank you very much, and we'll see you again. And thank you, Michelle.